It was indeed most significant for me is attracting people from different walks of life. So there were people like Rose Bond, who wrote a lot about the Buddha's early lives. And any number of translations were being made through this Buddhist Texts Society. And the best part is that, to a large extent, people who were quite unaware of India, they were made to be aware of India through Buddhism. Because they considered that Buddhism was a kind of a Protestant religion against Hinduism, which in reality is absolutely a wrong premise. Basically, because if you look at Buddha's life keenly, he represents the cream of Hinduism in India. But what he revolted against was against some of the practices that had crept into Hinduism, which were not considered to be good.
So, sorry, Buddha born a Hindu?
Yeah, he was a Kshatriya king. He was born in a republic of those days, approximately during the 6th century BC. And the 6th century BC represented a kind of a intellectual era where there was a lot of rethink that was going on. It was the time of some of the best brains, like Confucius in China. It was almost the same period when Socrates was at his peak in Greece. You had Mahavira taking birth during almost the same time. You had Ajita Kesha Kambala, who was considered to be a great thinker, where Buddha also seems to have spent some time. And there were quite a few others at that point of time. In fact, Buddha himself, in his works, mentions about the 7 great thinkers of the period. So this was the background, basically, with which we can look at. Because the novel, if you have to understand it properly, you will have to be clear what is represented in Buddhism and what is represented in Hinduism. But this line of demarcation is more artificial, because in later literature, particularly by the time we come across Kshemendra of 10th century AD, in his Dashavatara Charitam, for the first time we see that Buddha himself is accepted as one of the avatars of Hinduism.
Even in Bhagavata, he is accepted.
So the fact is that Indians never deemed Buddhism as a separate group. They looked at it as an independent group of people who believe in certain things which are slightly at variance with Hinduism. But if you go through the basic writings of Buddha, you will be very much attracted by the simplicity of his speech. In fact, the very first sutra which he uttered, Dhamma Chakra Pavattana Sutra, in Varanasi, in Mughalawa, it very clearly outlines what exactly he is going to teach about for the next 70-80 years. It's very clearly demonstrated in this very first speech. So the point is that Hermann Hesse, when he wrote this novel, already had a first-hand experience of life in India. And that too, in the most religious parts of the country, like Varanasi and other places. And to give some more details about the author, first, he was born in 1877 in Germany. He was brought up in a Lutheran household, where it was assumed that he was going to study for the ministry. His parents both served as missionaries in India, as I was mentioning earlier. He learned about Indian culture through their experiences and pursued an interest in Eastern religion and philosophy later in life. But the sad part is that for quite some time, he had to spend lot of his energies in trying to cure himself of psychological problems. And he actually was a patient of one of the famous psychiatrists, Carl Jung. You must have heard of his name, Carl Jung. And in his writings also, you come across a lot of imprint of Carl Jung's philosophy of psychology, his insight into the mind and so on. But later on, he grew into such a giant as far as literature is concerned. He authored quite a few novels. And there is always this psychological development of the individual in the backdrop of most of his themes. And in 1946, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature. He lived out his life in Switzerland during World War II and died there in 1962. And because of his views against Germany of the Third Reich, that is during the war, Second World War, he was virtually banned by Germany because of the views that he had, which were totally opposite to the views of the government of those days, the Nazi government. He suffered a lot in his personal life because of persecution and so on. And yet, his novels are totally bereft of any of such bitterness. That's the greatness of this man. Actually, the first translation of this work was done in 1951, although the novel itself was written in 1922. So in fact, this translation, which is more popular, of Hilda Rosner, this is the most popular translation. There are a couple of other translations also. In fact, one of the most interesting things is that works like this has the entire transcript of it, which has been read out. It's available for free for download from the internet. Works like this, VOXLIBRIS. So from that website, you will be able to download the entire book which is read out in about 12 parts.
The same book.
But not of this lady. It's of somebody else's.
Yes, there is.
There are a couple of translations from German to this. It's not that only one person has translated.
There are many translations.
So this English translation gained true popularity sometime during the 60s with the young counterculture movement that embraced Eastern philosophies. So that is basically, to put it in plain terms, the hippies. They popularized this work because they felt that here is one novel which tries to help you see the truth in your own view. So now let us come to the novel proper. So the novel starts in a very, very beautiful way. In fact, there is a guy called Sheldon Beacon, a great psychoanalyst. And he authored this work called If You Meet the Buddha on the Road, Kill Him. Don't be startled by the title. It is a koan. Koan is a statement in Zen Buddhism which startles you at first and then gives you an insight into that statement. So in fact, this statement is made by Liaji. Lingji, he is the author of this statement, If You Meet the Buddha on the Road, Kill Him. But it has been expanded into different meanings. A Zen master called Shunryu Tsukuji, he makes it this way: kill the Buddha if the Buddha exists somewhere else. You are the Buddha, you can't kill yourself. But if there is a Buddha outside you, then there is a duplication. There cannot be a Buddha other than you, so therefore kill them. So it also means that the search for your guru is futile, because in this world, if you have to succeed and if you have to learn, it is you who have to put in efforts. And no external element can enlighten you. In fact, that is actually the last statement which we come across in the novel also. So now the point is, this novel has been described by Sheldon Carr as Siddhartha is Herman Hesse's lyrical novel. He is a poetic retelling of one of the legends of the spiritual journey of the Buddha. Well, we will have to take whatever he says with a pinch of salt, basically because sometimes, out of the ignorance of the inner truths of India, they always tend to confuse with lot of things. So that apart, we get lot of gleanings of the novel in his writings. Well, if you look at the life of Buddha independently, that life is something which is really super. So the basic element in Buddha's growth of his inner self or his enlightenment, we all know he was a great king, a kshatriya. He had all the pomp and pelf to take care of in his life. And one fine night, he decides to desert his family and move away on the path of away. So, and this actually happens after he gets a son. And in the dead of the night, he moves away from the family. And then he gets into strict asceticism, where he gets so emaciated. And even the followers whom he had at that point of time, the five disciples, they desert. And one fine morning, he realizes that this asceticism is not going to lead him to the enlightenment that he seeks. And then, when he was sitting under the Bodhi tree, a spark of lightning to his mind occurs. And that was the moment when he is enlightened with regard to the true meaning of life, the problems associated with life, and the way through which these problems can be alleviated. So what he calls the four Arya Satyas, Arya Satya, and the Atthangiko Maggo, the eightfold path through which that path can be traversed, where you can alleviate the pain and suffering of this world. So that is Buddha. Siddhartha, on the other hand, has a slightly different journey from all of it. Siddhartha, the protagonist of this novel, and Gautama, the Buddha, are two different entities. So we'll have to be clear in our approach. We should not mix up the two characters. Though both, according to Herman Hesse, in this novel, are contemporary individuals. So let me look at the plot as such, so that as we go further, this will help us to understand the characters better and how Herman has woven a beautiful novel out of this simple truth. Siddhartha, the handsome and respected son of a Brahmin, lives with his father in ancient India. Everyone in the village expects Siddhartha to be a successful Brahmin like his father. Siddhartha enjoys a near idyllic existence with his best friend Govinda, but he is secretly dissatisfied. He performs all the rituals of religion and he does what religion says should bring him happiness and peace. Nonetheless, he feels something is missing. His father and the other elders have still not achieved enlightenment, and he feels that staying with them will not settle the questions he has about the nature of his existence. Siddhartha believes his father has already passed all the wisdom their community has to offer, but he longs for something more. In fact, the passage which I have meant to quote from the novel itself is important. I quote, that was how everybody loved Siddhartha. He delighted and made everybody happy. But Siddhartha himself was not happy. So as Cobb says, it was a very idyllic situation in which he was placed. He belonged to the highest Varna. His father was a great scholar. He practiced all texts which were supposed to be learned by rote during the early days of his education. He was an adept in discussions, that is, Shastrartha. Even today this happens in quite a few pathshalas. It will be a wonderful sight to watch all the debates take place. So now it is called Shalaka Goshtis in today's context. They are held regularly. So he had nothing to crave for, because he had everything that one should aspire for at that young age. And yet, everybody loved Siddhartha, he delighted and made everybody happy, but Siddhartha himself was not happy. So this unhappiness is mainly because he was not comfortable with the answers that were given by the traditional people whom he considered the elders of his year. So, and that was the time when some things happened in his life. One day, a group of wandering ascetics called the Shramanas passed through the town. They are stark and almost naked and have come to beg for food. They believe enlightenment can be reached through asceticism, a rejection of the body and physical desire. The path of Shramanas preach is quite different from the one Siddhartha has been taught, and he believes it may provide some of the answers he is looking for. He decides to follow this new path. Siddhartha's father does not want him to join the Shramanas, but he cannot dissuade Siddhartha. Govinda also wants to find a path of enlightenment, and he joins Siddhartha in this new time. Shramanas are ascetics.
What are Jains?
It could be Jains, it could be even the Brahminical Sannyasins or Avadhuts of this period, but not Buddhists. But typically the term Shramana is used to represent a Buddhist mentality. But in this novel, we have to understand the Shramanas as a separate category other than Buddhist monks. Because later in the story we come across the protagonist joining Buddha as a shaman of that order. So there is a slight difference in the etymological meaning that we have attached here. The shamana here is basically a non-Buddhist. So their practices are entirely different. So that's the reason why I say there are some basic contradictions in the conception of common heads on Hinduism. So when he speaks of the Brahminical approach, he quietly forgets that a Shramana or a Sannyasi is as much a Brahminical creation. So because we have that fourfold classification, the four ashrams, Brahmacharya, Garhasthya, Vanaprastha and Sannyasi. So the Shramana here is similar to the Sannyasins of the fourth of many. Siddhartha adjusts quickly to the ways of the Shramanas because of the patience and discipline he learned in the Brahminical tradition. He learns how to free himself from the traditional trappings of life, and so loses his desire for property, clothing, sexuality and all sustenance except that is required to live. His goal is to find enlightenment by eliminating his self, and he successfully renounces the pleasures of the world. sunburnt and hostile, Siddhartha soon ceases to resemble the boy he used to be. Govinda is quick to praise the Shamanas and notes the considerable moral and spiritual improvements they both have achieved since joining the Shamanas. Siddhartha, however, is still dissatisfied. It is basically an aspect of his personality. Because he is not satisfied with the Shamanas, then he moves on to the Buddhist cattle. Then again he is not satisfied. And ultimately the truth he learns is from an ordinary ferryman who ensures that people cross the river from one end to the other. So I will come to that a little while later. Siddhartha, however, is still dissatisfied. The path of self-denial does not provide a permanent solution for him. He finds out that the oldest Shamanas have lived the life for many years but have yet to attain true spiritual enlightenment. So here he does not concur with the statements of these Shamanas. He is not happy with moving with them. And then the Shamanas have been as unsuccessful as the Brahmana, Siddhartha and Govinda left behind, according to him. At this time, Siddhartha and the other Shamanas begin to hear about a new holy man called Gautama, the Buddha, who has attained the total spiritual enlightenment called Nirvana. Govinda convinces Siddhartha that both should leave the Shamanas and seek out Gautama. Siddhartha and Govinda inform the leader of the Shamanas of their desire to leave. So now the leader, as usual, does not feel very happy that these two people are going away. So just like his father, Siddhartha's father, who opposed his moving over to Shamanas, the chief of the Shamanas refuses to let him go with his own free will. But then with great reluctance, he permits them to go. So in fact, the novel makes a wonderful statement. The chief is so much enraptured by the gaze which Siddhartha gives to that Shaman. And that gaze is enough to make him permit Siddhartha let go of his power. So that was the core of his personality to begin with. And Siddhartha and Govinda find Gautama's camp of others and are taken in. Siddhartha is initially pleased with Gautama, and he and Govinda are instructed in the Eightfold Path, the Four Main Points, and other aspects of Buddhism. But here again, his intellectual curiosity is unsatisfied. He finds fault with a lot of inconsistencies in the teachings of Gautama the Buddha. So the two terms that we need to identify are Siddhartha for the protagonist of this novel and Gautama the Buddha, the great 6th century chief of Buddhist practices who started Buddhism. The two are entirely different. So Siddhartha.
But Siddhartha is also name of Gautama.
Gautama's early. Yes, that is early. See, there are quite a few metaphors in this.
It's very metaphoric.
There are a number of metaphors in this novel. I'll talk about it a little while later. Because when I look at the literary aspects of this novel, I'll comment about it. There are wonderful metaphors. Siddhartha decides to embark on a free life of meditation, basically because he finds that the Buddhist precepts are contradictory. Particularly when it says at one point of time that the world, all the present things in life are material, they should be eschewed. And the other which says that there has to be a universality of all the things that you have in life. So there has to be a kind of a universal approach to life. So there is some dichotomy which he finds. And he feels that Buddha does not explain all the factors to his satisfaction. So he breaks his links with Buddha and moves out. He decides to embark on a life free from meditation and a spiritual quest he has been pursuing, and instead learn from the pleasures of the body and the material world. So here, there is an interesting character that has been introduced, the courtesan Kamala. But at the initial stage, when he tries to approach her, she simply spurns him. Look, what sort of a person are you, and why should I have any links with you? You are not a rich man. You are not a man of city. In fact, that term that is used in Sanskrit is Nagarika. Not Nagarika, Nagarika. Say a person of city with his own tastes of depravity. So he is called a Nagarika. In fact, Vatsayana refers to that term very frequently in his book. But the point is that Kamala, when she confronts Siddhartha with his statement, Siddhartha reflects for a while. He says, yes, I don't have a beautiful dress, I don't put on good clothes, I don't use unguents, the ointments which make my body smell great. I'm not a very wealthy person, I don't trade in any goods. But yes, there is one way where I can please, where I can earn something. So that is through poetry. I can write poems, and maybe through that I can earn money. In fact, in one of the texts of Sanskrit poetics, Mamata, of the Kavya Prakasha of him, he says, Yashase Arthakrute Vyavahara Vide Shivetara Kshataye Satya Phala Nivrutaye. For all these reasons, Kavya needs to be written. So I can earn money through poems, because that was a period of literary excellence. So people admired the ability of a person to compose poems. So in fact, Kav summarizes that verse in this. She points out that he could no more do this than she could take the wisdom of a shaman. This context is, when Siddhartha confronts this courtesan Kamala, she spurns outright. You are nobody, why should I live with you? And then he poses a challenge. Well, what if I take you by force? I can rob you, and I can also use force to be with you. Then Kamala comes up with a very strong response. She says, he could no more do this. She could take the wisdom of a shamana from him against his will, which can never happen. You are a shamana. I can't force you to teach me. Same way, you can't force me to suffer. And she says, she could take the wisdom of a shamana from him against his will. Each must be given willingly, or not one drop of sweetness will you obtain from force. A very important statement. So it applies equally to anybody's life. In fact, there are quite a few such beautiful statements scattered in quite a few places in this novel. So then, how is he to earn the money she requires? His only talents are to think, to wait, and to fast. None of them are saleable. Then he remembers one other talent. He can compose poetry, and then he writes down a poem to her. Into her grove went the fair Kamala. At the entrance to grove stood the brown shamana. As he saw the lotus flower, deeply he bowed, smiling, acknowledging Kamala. Better, thought the young shamana, to make sacrifices to the fair Kamala than to offer sacrifices to the gods. So now, in this phase, of Siddhartha's life. The priorities have undergone a total change. A strict brahmachari, educated in all the right aspects of laws, very quickly succumbs to the temptation, knowingly and without much of questioning. Again, a statement from Bhagavad Gita comes to my mind. The whole of our perspectives are clouded by two things, desire and anger. Kamayesha krodhayesha, rajo guna samudbhava, born out of this guna of rajas, full of passion, full of action. And under these circumstances, even if you want to control, nigraha kim karishyate. These are the words of Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. The so-called self-control virtually disintegrates at the time of the need. This happens. And one parallel I might draw. In fact, this is the 50th year of samskara. 1967, Anantamurthy wrote samskara. I am 100% sure he was influenced by this text in portraying the character of Ranishacharya. Of course, he never acknowledges the souls, as is the wont with that generation of scholars.
Never yet.
But if you look at the parallels between samskara and Siddhartha, I am sure you will find a number of passages where the imprint of Dharmanas on samskara is absolutely clear and beautiful. Of course, samskara looks a bit more, what I would say, not so very well constructed in terms of the theme. Whereas here, you find a coherence which is not to be found in any other.
It's more revealing.
More revealing.
More revealing, samskara.
No, but see, samskara has lots of loopholes. The very fundamental basis of it is questionable. If you review that again in the context of some of the recent developments and things, you will find it to say absolutely illogical on quite a few things. So it probably looks at the depravity of a person who has fallen from his high pedestal. And definitely not an ideal situation that could be emulated by others. So it is something to be read and forgotten, rather than something to be read, remembered and chewed. No. So it does not get into that exalted position under any of these features.
Sir, in fact, S.L. Bhairappa pinpoints this aspect which you told. If he has read lot of all those things, he should not be doing all these things. Ideally, it's not a character which he is trying to portray.
So, Kamala is delighted, and in return, she teaches him the very treasures of love. And here stands the fall of Siddhartha to a large extent from our perspective. Because this leads Kamala introducing him to a character called Kamaswami, who is a businessman. So this businessman teaches him the art of running a business, and he now falls into this whole world of trade, money, enjoyment, flirting, drinking, and a whole host of other activities which will bind him more and more into this life. So a life which he wanted to avoid, he falls into that trap in a very miserable way. And then this life continues for a fairly long time. And during that period,
one night,
Siddhartha has a dream, a rather nightmare. All of us dream. There is not a single individual who does not dream. And all of us have our shares of nightmares. How many of us haven't had the nightmare of going to the examination hall without preparation and facing the fright?
Everybody in this.
So more than that, you see, we also have lots of these bad dreams which frighten us so much. When we wake up, we'll be sure it. We'll have perspiration. Our whole personality would have undergone a change. So now a similar dream he witnesses, which is so frightful from his part. I'll read out the passage and excerpt from the text itself. A small rare songbird, which Kamala kept in a small golden cage. This bird, which usually sang in the morning, became mute. And as this surprised him, he went up to the cage and looked inside. The little bird was dead and lay stiff in the floor. He took it out, held it a moment in his hand, and then threw it away on the road. And at the same moment, he was horrified and his heart ached as if he had thrown away with his dead bird all that was good and of value in the world. So here again is a long metaphor.
Yes, it's a metaphor.
That golden bird is none other than Siddhartha. The bird was caged by Kamala, and so is the case with Siddhartha, who was caged under her captivity. So he was bound to her. But this death of the bird, and after that death, what do you do? Bharya, bharya vibhyati tasmin kai. That's what Shankara says. Bhajagovinda is a great poem from that matter. So if a person is dead, nobody, not even the most important, closest relative, would suffer even a moment with that dead part. So that's the reality of life. And the reality of death too. And this nightmare has a major impact after he wakes. So this marks another awakening in his mind on the reality of life and how short-lived the pleasures are. You look at a similar episode in Kathopanishad. Nachiketa was offered by his father to Yama, the primordial chief of hell, or heaven, as you would call it. The god of death. He makes a statement when confronted by Nachiketa. He says there are two things in life. One is what is called present, the other what is called good. These two present themselves before an individual. A discriminating individual, a person with intelligence, will always opt for what is good. But a person with short-sightedness, who is interested in acquisitions and retentions, present things in life, will always choose what is present. Shreyascha prayascha manushyam ekai tau samparitya vivinanti dhira. But a person of lesser intelligence will always select what is present and not what is good. Yoga kshema guruni. Yoga is acquisition, not yoga in the sense of
Patanjali.
Yoga is to get. Kshema is to safeguard what you have earned. So he will be falling into this cycle, that path of to get, to retain, enjoy. So again, earn, retain. So this is a trap. So, when Yama offers him lots of things, look, you are too young, I'll give you land, you'll be the king, I'll give you lots of people, the dasis with whom you can enjoy life, I'll give you lot of money, gold, unmeasurable quantities, enjoy. Nachiketa comes out with a very strong response. He says, all these are fine, but do they last long? No. They have got a very small period of time through which you can enjoy. But I want something which brings the mind. Tavaiva vahaha tavadita nirudhi. So these are the words of Nachiketa. But here Siddhartha started as a Nachiketa in the real sense of the term. But very soon fell into that camp. So this is the reality of life also in beautiful places. Karyate hyavasham karma. Pragyate jayi gunai. That's what Krishna also says. See, the sense organs what we possess. And the various problems associated with our own approach towards these things, they create number of snares for us. Not so easy to come out of it. Even if we want to avoid them, like Duryodhana said, we will not be able to come out of it. He says in one context, Janami dharmam nachami pravruti. I know what is right, but I don't have inclination towards it. Janam yadharmam nachami nivruti. I know what is wrong, but I cannot come out of it. So this is the idea. So we have lots of issues of that kind. So then, here, Shadaka comments, nightmares are simply those dreams that we are too frightened to complete. So we get up and pick this thing. Fright, we come out of it. And then our thinking process also gets altered. We are objects. So here he gets a jolt because of that dream. And takes a very good decision to leave behind the joy of his prosperity, attachment towards Kamala, and his linkage with that world in which he was steeped till now. So he says, Siddhartha steals away from the city of samsara without saying that he is leaving. When Kamala learns that he has left, she weeps to realize that he remains a homeless pilgrim. She goes to her golden cage, opens the door, releases her great sambar and lets it fly away. Siddhartha has left without knowing that Kamala carries this chain at that moment. So now the point is, here again there is a good metaphor. By releasing that sambar, now she has mentally and intellectually severed her relationships with Siddhartha. She accepts the fact that Siddhartha no longer is with her and that she has to move on to the next stage, whatever. So that is the gist of this stage. So now he walks away. He'll be moving around the river banks, and because of his exhaustion, he falls on the ground out of thirst, hunger, everything. And then when he opens his eyes, whom does he see? He wakes to see a yellow-robed monk with a shaven head who turns out to be his old friend Govinda, who had been continuing his practices with Gautam Buddha. He finds it hard to believe that anyone dressed so elegantly as Siddhartha can possibly be on a pilgrimage. Siddhartha cries out and he tries to explain that he has lost his riches, but Govinda is dubious and goes on alone. The well-dressed pilgrim reflects on his situation and realizes that he has lost his only self just as long before he had lost his ascetics. So the problem which he has is that he is at the crossroads. Na dharma na dharma. He is neither there nor here. He has moved away from his spiritual path. So now he has moved away from this path of pleasure and he is not yet fulfilled in his desire to know that. So the moment of self-actualization has not come. He has learned nothing. Now that he is no longer young, he must begin like a child again, but rather than feeling grief. He felt a great desire to laugh at himself. So in transaction analysis, what does laughter signify? It signifies a child. Only a child can heartily laugh. Because in all other states of mind, we have our own innate things. Even for a smile, we expect something in return. But the laughter of the child is something which is winsome, which is pure, which does not have any attachments, which is absolutely free from any pain. So now he is back to square one as a joyful child person once more. Laughter is also the sound of freedom. Siddhartha no longer merely knows about, he understands the evils of the worldly life, and so he is free of it. So now from this transition, he moves on and he meets a ferryman called Vasudeva. Here again there is a long metaphor. Vasudeva is a person who carries people from one side of the river to the other side. He has a boat and always he very cheerfully spends his time in ferrying people. So now again in the whole context, the river is a samsara. So crossing one person, taking one person from one end to the other end, he is basically promoting him emancipation. So typically it is a metaphor for a person who guides you to achieve your freedom from life, mukti. In the whole process you come across a lot of philosophical gleanings which Vasudeva has earned through this kind of service.
But he gets to initiate his karma deva rounds Vasudeva.
Yes.
He has named them appropriately.
Very nice selections. So because Vasudeva in the context of, let us say, Bhagavata or Bhagavad Gita,
yeah,
is also the person who ensures that we move away from the worldly desires to a world of emancipation. And the river always signifies that samsara. So if you have to move across all these things, you require a ferryman who takes you safely with his skill.
In fact, the name Kamala also, it is very
lotus.
Lotus which actually grows,
yes,
in
dirty water, but that is pure by itself.
Yes.
So in fact the names are quite significant from that point. So Govinda went to kiss his friend and in Siddhartha's face he sees a continuous stream of other faces, faces of other people, of animals, of things. He sees that Siddhartha has achieved the Buddhahood. For his smile reminds Govinda of everything that he has ever loved in his life, of everything that had ever been of value and holy in his life. So before Siddhartha could discover that he needed no teacher, he first had to exhaust his longing for others to guide him, to take charge of his life. So too with the persons who undergo all these journeys. So typically, what it essentially says is that if you have to get enlightenment, the path of total asceticism is not the right path, because it will not help you to achieve your goal. It might incarcerate your body, and in the whole process it may bring only pain to you. So in fact, some Gandhara sculptures of Buddha show Buddha in that emaciated state, and it is so difficult for us to digest how much pain he must have undergone, because you find that his whole body, only bones are visible. There is no flesh at all. There is Gandhara sculptures of Buddha. So there are very real representations of Buddha just before his enlightenment. So then if you look at this Vasudeva, he simply hands over his boat, he abandons it and goes into the forest to meditate. Ultimately, that is the end of his path. And then in the meantime, we find Siddhartha stepping into that position, and he meets with his wife, that is Kamala. And Kamala by then had an 11-year-old child. And she discloses to Siddhartha just before her death because of a snake bite. And then Govinda addresses him to take care of the, Vasudeva addresses him to take care of the child. And he willingly does that. But when he wants to bring up through the enlightened path, the boy is already spoiled with the city life. He wants to go back to the city of his place, and he refuses to stay with these two ferrymen. So what anguish his father underwent when he moved away. On a diametrically opposite side, you find the nemesis of it, catching up with Siddhartha. So here the portrayal is really something, you know, which is very, very sweet, elegant, lyrical at times. The words that come out of the same author are something that one has to really see to believe. Couple of passages which I would like to quote. Siddhartha, he said, "Why are you waiting? You know why? Will you go on standing and waiting until it is day, noon, evening? I will stand and wait. You will grow tired, Siddhartha. I will grow tired. You will fall asleep, Siddhartha. I will not fall asleep. You will die, Siddhartha. I will die." Simple, direct dialogues. So these are the conversations with his father when he is determined to move on to the Shravanas group. Second passage, this is when he was spending his time with the Shramanas. Siddhartha learned a great deal from the Shramanas. He learned many ways of losing the self. He travelled along the path of self-denial through pain, through voluntary suffering, and conquering of pain through hunger, thirst, and fatigue. He travelled the way of self-denial through meditation, through the emptying of the mind through all images. Along these and other paths did he learn to travel. He lost himself 1,000 times, and for days on end he dwelt in non-being. But although the paths took him away from self, in the end they always led back to it. Some of the finest passages in the work. There is one thing that this clear, worthy instruction does not contain, speaking about Buddha's teachings. It does not contain the secret of what the illusions, the illustrious one himself experienced, he alone among hundreds of thousands. That is what I thought and realized when I heard your teachings. That is why I am going on my way, not to seek another doctrine. For I know there is none, but to leave all doctrines and all teachers and to reach my goal alone or die. So this was his reasons for moving away from Gautama Buddha. Very powerful statements and yet very simple. So on the whole, the characterization is really another area which I find very, very unique. Whether the character of Siddhartha, whether the characterization of Kamala or Kamaswami or Govinda or Vasudeva, each one of them comes out so brilliantly. But one question remains. Okay, at the end of it, what does Harman has tried to say through Siddhartha? The answer is very clear. He says, look, life has its own mysteries. The path chosen by your predecessors, or your peers, or your gurus, need not be your own. It's for you to find out what that path is and live it fully here and now. So this clearly appears to be the message of Harman Das in Siddhartha. Whereas comparing with samskara, you will find out, you will come to a lot of negativisms about samskara. Here, the character Siddhartha, who was trained as a perfect brahmachari in the roles of Yajna, moves with shamanas, falls into the samsara of material comforts and desires, gives it up because of an awakening through a shattering dream, pursues yet again the path towards that perfection with a single-minded determination. Do you find the same strength of character in Praneshacharya as portrayed by Ananda? At the end, the message which Ananda Murthy gives, if you ask me, is totally stupid. Praneshacharya's character is not ennobled by his statements. Here, despite Siddhartha going into other areas, they illustrate certain aspects of life which are as real as his wanderings with the shamanas. But look at Mada's statements which allure Praneshacharya to visit so many bad areas. The two are absolutely on two different streets. So this, to me, appears to be a wonderful novel which, if read in your original text, definitely will give you a lot of insight. And if you look at the way in which the ideals are exemplified here, Hinduism already has this concept of the fourfold values of dharma, artha, kama and moksha. All four have their place. But what marks this text slightly different is that while sublimated sex is kama, here it is somewhat a kind of raw poetry. And Buddha, if you look at it, did not fall a prey to that in his life. So the distinction between Siddhartha on one hand and Gautama the Buddha on the other will also underline these thoughts. So in fact, you should read a Kavya-like Buddha Charita by Ashok Kaushal, which unfortunately is not available in full. But in translations, it is available in full.
Is it available in
Kannada? In fact, one Kaushinath Poddar, he has brought it out beautifully in Kannada. Excellent prose.
Kaushinath Poddar.
Kaushinath Poddar. But it was published almost about 50, 67 years ago.
Gita
No. That is Hanuman Prasad Poddar.
Oh, okay.
So this gentleman is from Kannada. Mm-hmm.
But is it available?
No, not available. I have a copy. If you can promise me that you can convert it into PDF and give it to me.
He can do that.
It's a beautiful introduction.
So it's translated originally from Sanskrit?
From Sanskrit to English. See, some portions are available in Tibetan. So there was a guy called John Stark who translated it into English for the first time, including the passages from Tibetan. And that has been translated into Kannada. In fact, there was another gentleman, Surya Prakash Chaudhary, who has retranslated it into Sanskrit from Tibetan. So with this voice, I'm sorry, I have already taken 1 hour.
Is
there any room for asking questions?
Yeah, please, you are more welcome.
As you have read this book, I am to be inhabited for many years. So from the narration which I have heard from you, I have 3 questions, sir.
Yes.
The first question is, the young Siddhartha decides to leave his father's house. He goes and dwells with the customs of his father and his family in search of something else because he's not happy. That's what he said. And I would like to know whether the author has written explicitly in the book what was the cause of his unhappiness.
See, it is basically not limiting the knowledge transfer. See, whatever he learned, it was more through the regular, see, shloka, communicating to memory, repeating it. And there was no personal experience of any of the statements of truth that have been made. And he was longing to have a clarity on quite a few of the things. So now, for example, I'll just extrapolate. Harmanthas does not make it very distinctly. We always say, okay, Veda Pramanam, the final authority for things which are not directly perceived, they are not inferable. So because it comes under what is called the third category of proof of Aptavati. So there are only 3 means of knowledge. One, I should see you to believe that you exist. Second, I might infer. My friend told me that he has met you, so therefore I infer that it's right. So third, there must be some statement that you exist, in which I have faith. So these are the only 3 means of knowledge. But the third one which is very difficult to prove. Say for example, Swarga Kamo Yajeta. The Vedic text says, if you are interested in heaven, you should perform this sacrifice. So there is what is called the concept of punya, papa, and so on and so forth. So now that part, I will not be able to explain this. So now the questions which arose in the minds of young Siddhartha, they could not be quenched, they could not be answered to the fullest extent, to his satisfaction, by these traditional scholars, including his father. So he thought that whatever he was hearing from them has limitations. And he wanted to cross those limitations. It happens. It could be that the people who were speaking to him had themselves not realized the ultimate truth, and therefore their statements lacked authenticity. May I ask you a couple of questions? Do you belong to Bangalore?
Yes.
No. Why I'm asking that is, see, here we had some very thorough scholars. So we had quite a few people who are steeped in the Vedic knowledge. But a few words from a legendary person called rendu place Swamiji. That would make a difference. So if you hear from this person, the moment you sit near him, most of your doubts are cleared in mind. I have experienced that transcendent. Rangapriya Swamiji. Formerly HS Vardeshkachar of National College.
He was elder brother of Deshikachar.
Yes.
Deshikachar.
Deshikachar. Elder brother. Yeah. I mean, it's really an amazing experience. Even before I ask any question, he would have clarified quite a few of the doubts in a very significant way without giving us the burden of asking the question. I don't know whether you have had any such experience, but this was my
from the perspective of the book. Only the author writes a story.
So here, from the perspective of Harmonious, he does not stipulate the exact reasons of his disenchantment, but he thinks that quite a few passages.
Restlessness.
Yes.
Restlessness.
And likewise.
You have no other questions?
Second question could also be related to that.